Oscar, a Golden Globe, and many, many Grammys for her incredible talents as a singer-songwriter. This is her long-awaited new CD, The Bedroom Tapes. Please welcome Carly Simon.
I didn't love you as I turn onto Union Square. Maybe I didn't love you as I slip my token into the turnstile. Maybe I only need to think about the
funny.
And then my
we're just talking about babies at the break. Back with Carly Simon. How are you? I'm so happy to see you.
Oh, I'm so fine.
And you look really, really great.
Thank you. I feel excellent.
Excellent. Now, to the Bedroom Tapes, why is it called that?
It's called that because I ended up making the album in not my bedroom, but my daughter's ex-bedroom. All daughters have ex-bedrooms, but they have to come back and their teddy bears still have to be there. But anyway, right. So when I moved up to Martha's Vineyard, lock, stock, and barrel out of Manhattan, I knew that if I built a studio or put my studio downstairs, I'd never go to it. So I have this rule about 33 steps away. If something is more than 33 steps away, I don't go to it.
Understood.
So I had to make the studio within the 33-step limit.
Right.
And it was just down the hall in my daughter's bedroom. So I went through lots of different possible names for the album, mostly anagrams of my name, but I ended up with the simplest one, which is the bedroom tapes. And there's no insinuation, there's no sexual insinuation. It's just a matter of it being that room.
That's where you were. It could have been the dining room tapes.
In fact, I prefer sex in the dining room.
You prefer sex in the dining room. Good to know, Carly's Diamond. That's why people watch this show. They want to know those things. Now, a lot has happened to you from the last time you were here till now, and I'm happy to say that you're feeling great, but tell everybody, for the people who don't know, that you were diagnosed with breast cancer in between these two appearances.
That's right. The last time I was on here, in fact, was the impetus for me to go and have a mammogram, because I'd been one of those people who just kept putting it off and putting it off, and yet I had seen a lump for 3 years.
Right. But you were just afraid, right? But, you know, here's the thing. That's more normal than you would imagine because,
yes, it really is.
You know, women, we're good at pretending that everything's okay and not wanting to really look at the problems.
Yeah. And it's so important because I was living in much more fear then than I am now.
Right.
So that it's infinitely better to know. And even if it turns out that you have something that has to be dealt with, better sooner rather than later. And it's also something that I certainly lived through and I'm here to tell about. And it's funny, I was on another talk show and the host said to me the other night, I know it was the hardest thing that you've ever had to deal with. He said in the intro, as if I didn't get to choose myself what was the hardest thing in my life.
Right.
And in fact, I think that my son's illness was a lot harder for me than going through breast cancer. And I learned a great deal from having the experience, and when you get to be my age, everybody's dealt a little something in their life.
Sure.
And so the fact that I'm without one of my breasts, a friend of mine said, well, I always thought the two breasts was overrated.
But I'm so proud of you that you had the courage to do it. It just took one of the silly songs or something. You thought, well, then we were making it light, and that's a great thing to know. It really is.
It was. I often give you credit, Rosie, for having.
Well, not just me. The women who come and say, you know, makes a big difference.
Yes.
And so you had chemo, I know, and it's not never fun, but it's definitely doable.
You know, chemo wasn't as bad as I thought. It was more an inconvenience because you can't really go anywhere, because when your blood count gets very low, you can't be exposed to a lot of viruses. So I had to stay home a good deal of the time. And which is why I started writing these songs, by the way, was because I was alone a good deal of the time with my musical equipment. It was after the chemo was over that I was really surprised about. I really felt bad then. And you might say, well, why after the chemo was over? And you don't expect it to happen. They don't really tell you that it causes, or that it's going to happen, because it doesn't happen to everybody. But it does happen to someone. And I finally got one of the nurses to tell me, and she said, oh, that's called the chemo crazies.
Right, because all your hormones get sort of shaken up and there's lots of toxicity in your body in order to help you get well, and that's a medical clinical thing.
It's a clinical thing, and your brain becomes, well, I mean, probably the neurotransmitters change shape or direction, or the enzymes change, and you go through a little battlement, you know, inside your brain, and just to kind of restore all the natural synapses takes some time.
Right.
And I didn't know that I was going to be, you know, that depressed from it. And it lasted for a good long time. It lasted for about 5 or 6 months. But as my doctor finally explained to me, it's good depression, because it means that things are going back to normal. But
right.
I just wasn't aware that was going to happen. So if anybody is out there having had chemo and wondering why you're feeling like you want to, you know, jump out a window, that's why, and it will get better.
My friend Marjorie, who had ovarian cancer when she was going through chemo, she's a comedy writer and a very, very funny woman, and she said, what can you say about chemotherapy that hasn't been said in 100 pop songs? You know? She had this great outlook. She used to walk around the chemo room making all the other people laugh, and, you know, it so changes your, I think, your survival rate if you have a good outlook going in, don't you think?
Well, you have to laugh. You have to laugh at all stages of your life. no matter what you're doing.
Right.
There's a song on the album called Scar. Did you listen to the song? It's about the wisdom that is gained during a serious illness or during any kind of life-threatening condition, whether it be depression or, you know, surviving an accident or surviving a divorce or surviving a child's being sick. It's a wound, and the scar forms, and it's the scar that you live with and that makes you, you know, you should wear your scar like you wear a badge.
Exactly, because you survived and here you are, and they all come together to make you you.
And scars are beautiful.
I think so too.
They're beautiful. And it takes a, you know, a really good man loves a really good scar.
Right.
And that's a, you know, I mean, don't hang out with any men that don't rub your scars, that don't want to kiss your scars, you know, that don't want to just hold you in their arms and just say, I love you for your struggle.
Right. And I'm so glad you're here. You're looking great.
Thank you.
You're sounding
Lizzie.
Great. Were you nervous
Thank
at all? Because I know you had a little nervous problem a few years ago.
I was a little bit
Because you were so good. You're going to do it again, and I'm going to sing with you? A little anticipation?
Yeah, you want to do that again right now?
I think. Yeah, you want to do it again? She's going to sing again. This time, Anticipation. We'll be back right after this with Carly Simon. From Tapes is the new CD, and here with world-renowned harpist Andreas Vollweider. Say that three times quick. Vollweider. There you go. We're going to sing right now. Carly Simon, ladies and gentlemen. Take it. You're a dream. Carly Simon, we're going on tour. We'll be right back. Don't go away. Great job.